Good morning, Harvest. How's everybody doing today? Good, good. Man, it's nice. Isn't it great to be in the house of the Lord today? For I was glad when they said, "Let us go to the house of the Lord." Man, the weekend is my favorite part of the week. Don't tell any of my coworkers that. But I love being here with you guys on the weekends. And, you know, before we open up God's word this morning, I wanted to take a moment to thank you all for welcoming me and my family here at Harvest. Here's a picture of my wife, Kathleen, and my daughter, Gabriella. You might have seen, thank you. You might have been accosted by my daughter to donate a backpack, so we're sorry about that, but she is very, very excited about serving the Lord. In fact, this weekend I asked her if she was going to come to hear me preach, and she said no. And I'm like, well, why? What's going on? This doesn't happen that often. Well, I'm serving this weekend in Harvest Kids, so that's what she wanted to do. So, and she's heard me preach a lot. She's probably tired of it by now. But my daughter loves it here. In fact, she made this tribute to Harvest. This is my office door. And you'll see these are all of her post-it notes over the last year. You'll see "You Are Love," HCA, which stands for Harvest Christian Academy. You have witness, word, walk, worship. She is so fired up about this church as we are as well. And this next picture is my first milestone moment here at Harvest. This was a little bit over a year ago. I just got on staff and they told me that I was going to be preaching in 30 days. And I'm like, okay, talking about trial by fire. But Beth Freeman had snapped this picture of me. But this picture, I didn't know that anyone was taking pictures, obviously. But it really, really made me feel at home here and made us feel really comfortable. So I just thank you guys for that. I thank Beth for the picture. We came from a church that we had served in for 12 years. I was an associate pastor there for about 6 of those years. And when we had the opportunity to come over here, it was nothing that we were searching out. It wasn't on the radar. So we had to, of course, take some time and make sure that this was God's will for our life. So we had the time to pray about it. And we did some fasting in there as well. I like to joke and say that I dated Harvest for about 6 months before I committed. So, but I'm glad I did. So let's go ahead and get into God's word. I am so excited to continue our unsung series on everyday people with an uncommon faith. And this week we are going to talk about Rahab's faith. The sermon title is Risking It All to Have It All. Risking it all to have it all. Let's go before the Lord in prayer. God, I just thank you for this time. You know, I was glad when they said, "Let us go to the house of the Lord." So we will rejoice, but we can't do it without you. So we just welcome your presence in here. I pray that you allow the words to do what they are meant to do. Let it bring forth change in the lives of people who might be broken or looking to hear from you today, God. I just pray that you show up in a mighty way. In Jesus' name, amen. So Rahab, risking it all to have it all. What is it that causes ordinary people to take risks? What prompts people to gamble by skydiving or race car driving or white water rampaging? I don't know if that's the proper term for it. But what causes people to do these extreme things? Psychologists say that it is more of a personality trait rather than a behavior. Some people love taking risks, and they thrive on the adrenaline rush and feeling an escape of the ordinary. However, the majority of us prefer not to take many risks at all. Some of us prefer to stay in our comfort zone and under some sort of security. Some of us like dotting all of the I's and crossing all of the T's. In fact, we don't mind taking risks as long as someone else is doing it, right? Right? That's why extreme sports is so popular, right? Jesus made it clear that following him would require risk. In fact, he wants us to risk everything to follow him. In his parable of the talents, remember, Jesus came down hard on the one talent man because he didn't take any risk with his money. Jesus tells us to deny ourselves and pick up our cross and follow him. Following Jesus is not for the faint at heart. It's a life that will be challenging, but it is a life that reaps rewards. Today we're going to meet a woman whose name was Rahab, who had a faith that moved her beyond her comfort zone and caused her to take some risks. What do you guys say that, anybody, who drove to church today? Anybody? Okay, that's the majority of people. All right. Did you know that you were taking a risk when you got in the car this morning? Do you know that statistics say that it is riskier to drive a car than it is to fly in an airplane? Did you know that? I'm sure you guys are smart people. I'm sure you knew that. But isn't that amazing? Imagine this. You're driving to church, let's say, and you're approaching an intersection, and you get about 100 feet away from the intersection, and the light is about to change. It changes yellow. So what are you going to do at that moment? This is the moment. This is a split-second moment, right? Now, don't answer this question out loud, but what are you going to do at that moment? Well, are you going to hit the accelerator and try to beat the red light? Or are you going to stop right there on the dime, not taking any more chances? The decision that you make at that moment is going to depend on three factors, right? It's going to depend on your schedule and if you're running late. It's going to depend on how you feel about obeying the law, right? And it's going to depend on how you feel about explaining a ticket to your spouse. Either way, once you've made that decision, there's going to be many more decisions you're going to have to make after that, right? Decisions we make in a split second will always depend on what we believe about ourselves and what we believe about society and what we believe about God. When we turn to the book of Joshua, we see a woman who made a risky decision that changed her life and her family's life. Her name was Rahab, and Rahab was a prostitute, so needless to say, she had already made some major decisions about her body and about her soul. In Joshua chapter 2, we meet her as she faces yet another decision, but to understand this story, we need to go back about 40 years and set the stage for Rahab's risky decision. You see this map here. The Israelites, the map isn't there yet. Okay, there it is. God's people, the 12 tribes of Israel, under the leadership of Moses, Aaron, and Miriam, went through a long season of unbelief. They refused to enter the promised land, so they wandered in the Sinai Peninsula, which we now know as Saudi Arabia. And right now, Saudi Arabia is mostly desert, but then it was all desert. And so there's no water, there's no food, but you may know from the story that God still provided. But during that time, an entire generation died, and our scene opens up with the 12 tribes of Israel encamped on the other side of the Jordan River. They are ready to invade Canaan under the new leadership of their new commander-in-chief, Joshua. The city is Jericho, and Jericho is the first city that the Israelites would have to take. It controlled a lush valley, a lush green valley, and in the book of Exodus, God had promised his people a land flowing with milk and honey. And the first city in their path fit this description perfectly. The land was fertile and well-watered, overflowing with abundant crops and luscious fruits. The city itself was the strongest of the fortified cities in Canaan. Jericho was occupied by the Canaanites. The Canaanites were mentioned over 150 times in the Bible, and the Canaanites were winners. They were like the New England Patriots of the Old Testament, all right? Some of you guys might not like that comparison, but they were winners is what I'm trying to say. But they were wicked, idolatrous people. They descended from Noah's grandson, Canaan, and as you know, Canaan was cursed because he sinned against his grandfather, Noah, in Genesis chapter 9. The city of Jericho seemed impenetrable. Its mud walls were 20 feet high. Archaeologists say that there were actually two walls. The first wall, between the two walls, was a room-sized gap so that if you made it over the first wall, you could potentially be trapped. You could potentially fall in the middle and be trapped, making yourself an easier prey for the Canaanites. So needless to say, Jericho was well protected. Over the gaps of these walls were houses at designated spots around the city. And one of these houses is where Rahab lived. So the story begins in Joshua chapter 2, verse 1. It says, "And Joshua, son of Nun, sent two men secretly to Shittah as spies, saying, 'Go, look over the land, especially Jericho.' And they went, and they came into the house of a prostitute whose name was Rahab. She lodged there, and it was told to the king of Jericho, 'Behold, men of Israel have come here tonight to search out the land.' Then the king of Jericho sent to Rahab, saying, 'Bring out the men who have come to you and entered your house, for they have come to search out all the land.' But the woman had taken the two men and hidden them. She said, 'True, the men came to me, but I do not know where they were from. And when the gate was about to be closed at dark, the men went out. I do not know where they went. Pursue them quickly, for you will overtake them.' But she had brought them up to the roof and hid them with stalks of flax that she had laid in order on the roof. So the men pursued after them on the way to the Jordan as far as the fords. And the gate was shut as soon as the pursuers had gone out." So this is the second go at it for the Israelites. If you remember in Numbers chapter 13, Moses had an opportunity to go in. But that time he sent in 12 spies and only one of them came back with a good report. And that was Caleb. So needless to say, they didn't go in that time. But this time they're going in. So in preparation for war, the spies were sent in, and they landed at Rahab's house. But so it makes sense that they land there, right? Because her house was on the wall. So this is probably the first place that they had encountered. Clearly, the spies had aroused some suspicions among some of the people of Jericho, and it made it all the way up to the king. So the king sends guards to Rahab's house. So Rahab had an opportunity to tell the truth if she wanted to, right? She knew how strong Jericho soldiers were, right? But she chose not to. In fact, she chose to tell a lie. I noticed what you guys were thinking. You're like, but Ramirez, she lied. Well, let's talk about that. Do you think... Don't answer this question out loud. This is just something you can think to yourself. Was it a righteous lie? Ask yourself that question. The first thing that needs to be pointed out here is that nowhere in the verse is any inclination of Rahab being praised for lying. We know that in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 31, it says, "By faith, Rahab the prostitute did not perish with those who were disobedient, because she had given a friendly welcome to the spies." So Rahab's faith was praised for receiving the spies in peace. But then again, there was no praise for lying. Rahab was not righteous for lying, but for her deeds and her faith. So Rahab's lie was not justified, is the answer to the question. And She was only justified by her actions through faith. Lying is never condoned by God, regardless who does the lying or what the circumstances might be. There is no such thing as a righteous lie. Nonetheless, Rahab acted with integrity based on the limited understanding that she had of God and the Bible at that time. However, there's evidence of a changed life here. There's evidence. A former prostitute who was once a child of Canaan is in the process of becoming a daughter of Zion. What on earth convinced her that she would do better betraying her own people and risking her life and her family's life to save two men who she did not know and did not know if she would see ever again? Like many decisions that we make, Rahab's decision came out of who she was and what she believed about herself, about the world she lived in, and about God. What she believed gave her courage to take a risk and go against her people and her government and her lifestyle. So for Rahab, the risk was worth it. We've arrived at the first fill in the blank here, and I want you guys to fill in here. Uncommon faith re-examines your allegiances. It is through faith that allows us to let go of the grip of the things around us. It is through faith that allows us to turn the direction of the minority instead of going into the direction of the majority. Listen to what Rahab said to the spies after the soldiers left on their pointless search. We continue here in verse 8. It says, "Before the men lay down, she came up to them on the roof and said to the men, 'I know that the Lord has given you the land, and that the fear of you has fallen upon us, and that all of the inhabitants of the land melt away before you. For we have heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea before you when you came out of Egypt, and what you did to the two kings of the Amorites who were beyond the Jordan at Sihon and Og, whom devoted you to destruction. And as soon as we heard it, our hearts melted, and there was no spirit left in any man because of you. For the Lord your God, he is the God in heaven above and on earth beneath.'" That is a powerful statement. This is Rahab's confession of faith right here. She acknowledges that the God of Israel is the God of heaven above and of earth beneath. Rahab decided to bet her life and her family's life on their future on Israel's God. She had become convinced that God was God in heaven and God on earth below. She now fears God and is showing respect for him. A healthy fear and respect and reverence for the Lord is the only way that we can confront our culture or go against the tide of society around us. We find courage to do that only when we are convinced that our God is the God of heaven above and on earth below. I am convinced that my times and your times are in God's hands, and his hands are good, and I believe that he has the whole world in it. We can be sure that his hands are good. And when we see justice and triumph and good went out in every situation, we can then, that will then allow our faith to blossom. When we look at the world around us and we see injustice triumph, we see the good guys lose and the bad guys win. We see a close friend having to cope with a broken marriage. And we see an honest husband lose his job at the same time that a dishonest coworker is promoted. We can see situations in life that cause many of us to believe that God might not be sovereign. Rahab knew enough about God to believe that he would use his great power to benefit his own, and she wanted to be his own. She knew how thick the Jericho walls were. She lived on them. She knew how ferocious the Jericho soldiers were. I'm sure she heard them bragging about the many victories that they had. But yet and still, despite all of that, she still came to believe that the God of Israel would triumph over all, and that God was on the Israelite side. She believed that so thoroughly that she was ready to bet her life on that reality. Rahab dared to stand alone against her culture because she had a strong faith in Israel's God. Her decision was made easy because she recognized the power of God. Your second fill in the blank here will be uncommon faith recognizes God's power. Let's continue in verse 12. Rahab says, "Now then, please swear to me by the Lord that as I have dealt kindly with you, you will also deal kindly with my father's house, and give me a sure sign that you will save alive my father, my mother, my brother, and sisters, and all who belong to them, and deliver our lives from death." And the men said to her, "Our life for yours, even unto death. If you do not tell this business of ours, then when the Lord gives us the land, we will deal kindly and faithfully with you." This is a very interesting situation here. Rahab is going to bat for her family. And it's interesting because during this time, that was unheard of. Women didn't speak too much. They did not have a lot of authority back then. I don't agree with that, obviously, but that's just how it was. Here she is. She's saying, "I'm saved. I'm going with the God of Israel. This thing is coming down. Israel's God is on the other side of the river, and he's coming here, and he's going to destroy this place. So I want to be saved. I want my father to be saved. My mother, sister, brother, nieces, nephews to be saved." How symbolic is this of the world that we live in today? The Israelites were coming to the mighty and powerful Jericho, and they were going to destroy it. And Rahab knew it. The amazing thing is that all of Jericho knew it. But she was the only one that chose to go with Israel's God. Remember, she said that we heard of what you've done to the Amorites. We heard that your God, we all heard. And when we heard, the spirit left us, meaning they lost courage. But she said, "I know what I'm going to do. I'm going with Israel's God, and I'm going to be saved, and my family is going to be saved." How is that working out for us? We're saved. Are we concerned about our family? We know that the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords is going to return someday, and we're going to be saved. But where would our family be in that? Rahab here was saying that I'm not okay with the culture around me. I'm not okay with this lifestyle that I'm living anymore. I am turning my life over to the God of Israel today, and my family is too. Number three, the third fill in the blank is uncommon faith removes the barriers. The barriers, the obstacles, the things that keeps us from sharing the good news. The things that keeps us from witnessing to others have been shattered. She's saying here, "I am not ashamed of the gospel. I'm not ashamed." The gospel had not been created yet, technically, but you know what I mean. Let's continue on. Verse 15. "Then she let them down by rope through the window, for her house was built on the wall, on the city wall, so that she lived in the wall. And she said to them, 'Go into the hills, or the pursuers will encounter you, and hide there 3 days. until the pursuers have returned. Then afterwards you may go your way. The men said to her, we will be guiltless with respect to this oath of yours that you have made us swear. Behold, when we come into the land, you shall tie a scarlet cord in the window through which you will let us down. And you shall gather in your house your father and your mother, your brothers, and your father's household. Then if anyone goes out of the doors of your house into the street, his blood shall be on his own head. We shall be guiltless. But if a hand is laid on anyone who is with you in the house, his blood shall be on our head. But if you tell this business of ours, then we shall be guiltless with respect to your oath that you have made with us, swear. And she said, according to your word, so be it. And then she sent them away, and they departed, and she tied the scarlet cord on the window. Number four, uncommon faith responds with obedience. She accepted Jesus Christ by faith, but now there was some work that she had to do. She had to be obedient to what they were telling us to do. And a scarlet cord is red. So this is a red cord. And if we move over to Exodus, you don't have to go there. Exodus 12, you'll remember, Pharaoh's heart had become hardened. So God had placed a number of plagues on the city. And the last plague was that every firstborn son of every household was going to die unless you went through the process of taking a perfect lamb and killing it, or I like to use the word here, slaying it, taking the blood and wiping blood across the doorpost of your house, then your household would be saved. Symbolic of the lamb that was slain. Notice in this verse, she says, go away for 3 days and come back. Jesus rose on the third day. We have a red cord symbolic of his blood. Their house is now under the blood, symbolically. So their house was protected. Their house was saved. God's covering on our house is so important. When you have God's covering on your house, the gates of hell cannot prevail. You are protected. You and your family will be saved. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Rahab, this great woman of faith. But we learn something more important about Rahab's faith when we move over to the New Testament. This is so interesting. To our surprise, we find the prostitute held up as an example of outstanding faith. You'll find her in what is known to be the Faith Hall of Fame, which is Hebrews chapter 11, and she's in there with Moses, Noah, Abraham, Sarah, Rahab, the prostitute, in the Hall of Faith. But look at also James chapter 2, verse 25. You guys can make a note of this to reference it later. It says, and in the same way, was not also Rahab the prostitute justified by works when she received the messengers and sent them out by another way? For as the body apart from the spirit is dead, so also faith apart from works is dead. Rahab's faith not only led to a strong statement about Israel's God, but remember she said, your God is the God of heaven above and of earth below. It also led to a strong action by God's people. Make a note of this. Strong faith leads to strong action. Strong faith leads to strong action. Faith is just not a statement. Faith is a step. There's some work, always work involved. faith without works is dead. The writer of Hebrews said that the fact that she had welcomed the spies demonstrated her faith. Rahab's faith led her to action. Her decision to act grew out of her faith, which allowed her, or which made her, bet her life on the God of Israel. And in betting her life, she obtained eternal life. If you grew up in Sunday school, you know the story better than I can tell it. You know the walls came tumbling down. And they not only came tumbling down. After they came tumbling down, the city was burned to the ground. Nothing was left standing. No Canaanite was left alive. But there's more to this story. In Joshua 6, the writer tells us that Rahab lived amongst the Israelites to the day the book of Joshua was written. So she became one of the people of God. The fact that she had been a prostitute was no longer relevant. By faith, she had joined into a community of God, which is so important. This is why small groups are so important, guys. That once you find faith in the Lord, it's important to get near people who are doing the same thing. Iron sharpens iron. Community is important. Rahab reminds us that being joined to the family of God has nothing to do with our goodness, but with his goodness. Through a prostitute, God teaches us that we are saved by grace, not by being good. But Rahab's story is not over. If we turn to the first chapter in Matthew, where you'll see this long genealogy report, and it's not to be read late at night, okay? But it's some really good information. But if you go down to verse 5, it says, Salmon, the father of Boaz, whose mother was Rahab. Rahab, the mother of Boaz. Even more amazing, she is an ancestress in the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory. Rahab, the prostitute. Wouldn't you think that God would have used someone else in the lineage of Jesus Christ? Right? No. That's God showing us that he can use even someone who is as down and out as a prostitute to save you. No one is beyond being saved, ever. Rahab stands as a tribute to the possibilities of God. God saw in her the possibility of an active, invigorating faith. Never mind who she was or what she had, or no, never mind what she was, all right? We need to look at, and God looked at, what she could become. That's what it's all about. It's the same for us. Our past is irrelevant. It is the future that matters. Faith can blossom in any environment, whatever lies behind us. The choices we made in the past, it doesn't define you. What defines you is what you do today, tomorrow, next week, and next year. That is what defines you. Some of the choices we might take in our lives might involve a certain level of risk. But again, that risk is going to be determined on what you believe about your world, but most importantly, about our God. Those decisions will determine the actions we take. Rahab heard about Israel's God, and she responded. She responded. She just heard. She responded. There's people who come to church every week, and they hear, but they don't respond. Today, we're going to give you an opportunity to do that. She gained salvation for her whole family. History tells us that Salmon, her husband, was actually one of the spies. It also gained her a place in the genealogy of King David. The list goes on and on and on. What resources do we fall back on when we have to make a split decision? Here's a woman who made a strong stand for God because of what she heard. And she was bold about it. She made a strong stand, and then she said, okay, brother, sister, mother, niece, nephew, cousins, you're going to do the same thing. Are our decisions grounded in our faith in a loving and compassionate God whose hand is on you and on us for good? Do our actions show our faith as we go with God and his people? Look at Rahab. Look at this prostitute who modeled invigorating and a vibrant faith. She's an example for us. That's why she's there. God put her there to minister to each and every one of us. Nobody in this room has done the things that she's done or lived the lifestyle that she has. Or maybe there is. The last fill in the blank here is uncommon faith reaps the rewards. Uncommon faith reaps the rewards. I want to leave you guys with this verse as well. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. It says, therefore, anyone, therefore, if anyone is in Christ Jesus, he is a new creation. All old things have passed away. Behold, the new has come. You know, this great thing about this life that we live and what we have through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, is an opportunity to get back up again. When we fall down, we get back up. So many people get weary by life. Life is hard sometimes, right? Life can be hard. But we have a promise in a risen Savior who is coming back. He's going to crack the clouds, and he's going to come back with all power and all authority. And the gates of hell will not prevail. Yeah. But our Lord is a gentleman, right? He doesn't force anything on anybody. He's a gentleman. He's willing and ready to receive us at any time, no matter what we've done. Look at Rahab. Look at her as an example of a life turned around. And I want to give someone an opportunity today. I'm feeling led to do this. So what we're going to do, we're going to do one more song. But during that song, I want to encourage anyone to come down. Whether if you're not a believer, we want to help you with that. If you've never accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, we want to help you with that today. We don't want anyone here to leave the same way that they came. Or if you've accepted Jesus Christ already and you slipped up this week, or today, or yesterday, we want to give you an opportunity to get it right today. Today is the day of salvation. Tomorrow is not promised. We're going to have some people to pray with you, some people on our prayer team, and they're just going to be tucked away in these corners over here. So it's going to be very discreet, okay? If you don't want to do it out here, we can go behind the curtain. But we have to do this. This is an opportunity for someone. And we're not judging you. We just want to love on you. God loves you. Don't miss this opportunity. Tomorrow is not promised. So let's go before the Lord and pray. God, I just thank you for this opportunity. I just pray that you move in the hearts of those who are broken, who are lost, or who just need a reset button. God, I just pray that you just move on their hearts to where they get out of the seat. Pull them out of their seat and bring them up to the front so that they can see who you are and what you can do in a broken life. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.